All electrolytic caps are replaced by new ones, different brands, but they are also all blue. Another electrolytic cap is here on the focus board on the lower side here. Another sits here on this side here. In general, it was possible to get same values, only some capacities are not available in axial construction mode, only in radial, but my distributor has not every value in an axial version, so I've chosen the next higher one, for example, for a 33 microfarad, I've chosen 47 microfarad. And sometimes a little bit a higher voltage rating, but it's not a problem because the newer capacitors are smaller in size than the older ones, so they still fit into the PCB board here. This is not exchanged, the big capacitor, we talked about it because it seems to be okay. And I resoldered also some of the wires because I had the feeling that some of the connectors here a little bit of reflection here. That's some of the reflection. So some of the, you see it on the reflection, some of the range here is a little bit black, not so good. This here is a range of the rectifier here, the area of the rectifier. There are some diodes here where I resoldered all pins. I added some additional wiring, some wires here and so on. Hope it's okay, checked optically, inspected everything, and now I'm sure that the power supply is okay and I will reinstall it into the scope. The power supply board is in place again here, it's mounted here, with this board here. This is a power transformer for the power supply from the line, 50 Hertz. This is a small transformer here for the 40 kilohertz switched power supply. Everything is wired again, all pins are connected here, which are coming from the power supply here and other plugs. So the instrument is ready now for energization again. Before I plug in, I want you to show the plug. This will be a topic in a few minutes. We will see why it is a topic. After switching on, we have a nice screen here. No ripple on the signal here. Channel A, channel B, both channels chopped, added. No problems here. In the range of 20 millivolt, with increased sensitivity down to 2 millivolt. We have here still some ripple on it, some noise. And now the point begins to be interesting, what I showed you. We have a plug, mains plug with only two connectors. That means the chassis of the scope here is not grounded, it's isolated. And I've seen when I touch the chassis here, then this effect disappears, there's no noise. The triggering becomes a little bit unstable. It wants to trigger. But as you see, when I touch it, it becomes better. I have here a grounded lead. I connect it here to the scope. And when I take it away, we at once have a little bit of ripple on it. It's at 2 millivolt maximum sensitivity. So this scope has an advantage. It is isolated. This is good for some measurements, not to have the mains ground here distributed into the test circuit. But on the other hand, it's a little bit dangerous because the scope here is not isolated and is isolated. And if there's some voltage on it, then you have also the voltage here on the case and you can touch it. Let's check in next step the supply voltages, whether they are now okay regarding value and regarding ripple. Again, I have here my board layout. And then let's start with a minus 180 volt. Minus 1 is now 181. It was 86 before, 81. It dropped a little bit with the new capacitors. The next one is plus 180. Not so good. 87. It was 181. It is 180.7 now, and it was 181. Okay, nearly the same. The next one is plus 38. 38.4 is also okay. Then plus 12 volt, it's now 11.9 as it was. It was also 11.9 before. Here we have plus 5 volt. It decreased a little bit, 5.09 it was. It was now 5.14, okay. And now the most interesting voltage. The minus 12 is now minus 12.2. It was minus 10.2, you remember. That was the voltage which dropped considerably below the nominal value. Now it is okay, the voltage here. And the last one is the ground here, 0.00. As we see, the voltages are now within the range they should have. And the next step is to measure the ripple with the scope. Now we are measuring the ripple again, as in the earlier sequence of the video. I will start at minus 180 volt here. This is a pin here. The signal comes from minus, the capacity has to charge. Oh, okay, it's much smaller than before. It's a peak of nearly 200 millivolt in respect to 180 volt is 0.1%, it's one promille. It's a very, very small ripple. If I would have a juice cable with 180 volt, we couldn't see it. Plus 180 volt. We have to wait again. A little bit more, but also acceptable. Next is plus 38. This pin here. Okay, it's rather small. Nearly nothing. The next one is plus 12 volt. Oh, that's really good. Can this be true? Yes. I have a sensitivity of 1 millivolt now, 10 millivolt with a probe. There's only a little bit to be seen here. The triggering is a little bit problematic. Let me use HF. Low frequency, high frequency. Okay, well, there's some AC overlapped, but in general it's very low. The next one is minus 12, you remember it was very bad. When I go back to 20 millivolt as we had in the video sequence before, we see nothing. At 20 millivolt, so the signal is very stable. Here is a plus 5 volt, the last one, which is also very stable here. The voltage is nearly constant. The ripple is also can be seen only in the highest resolution with 1 millivolt here, 10 times, so it's 10 millivolt. So we have 5 millivolt ripple or something like this. From revert to 5 volt, it is 1 promille ripple. It's also okay here. So we can say values and voltage ripples are now okay. The change of the capacitors was very good. It was necessary, but it helped also. It was not in vain. It was very useful. Now I will do some basic tests. I've connected a triangle signal approximately 100 kHz to the input of channel A and try some functions regarding delay, time base, a little bit storage and so on. The first culprit I see here is the attenuator. The contacts are not so good. When I touch it, they get better or worse. But in general, they seem to operate, to work. Triggering is also stable. I have DC trigger with variable level. Look on the left side here. I can shift the trigger level from maximum to minimum nearly before it fades out. So I think this is in general okay. In AC mode, I have the same possibility here. So I think it's rather okay. That's the center position. I have triggering at zero. Slope positive, when I take it out, slope negative, same also. So in general, it looks rather good here. Time base reacts, of course. It looks also very, very good here. What is this? Why is it so dark here? Does it make any sense here? Is it a hold-off function? Ah, okay, there's a hold-off function. Sorry, I've not realized that there was a hold-off on the wrong side here. But I think it's okay. And now in this slow position, we can try the alternate time base here. The delay time base. Off, I have it on here. Ah, interesting, a little bit more intensity, reduce the amplitude. And with this pot here, I can move the position here, but I've triggered, I should have a trigger related to mine main time base, so I can move here the window a little bit. I think this is better here, okay. For demonstration, can make this time shorter here. In general, it seems to work. And when if this is delayed time base triggered to the main time base here, delay time can be adjusted when I trigger it to time base to channel A. Then it jumps from position to position, and it is always triggering at a certain level here. Okay, we can change the level here, and when I change the time, then it jumps to the next window where the trigger condition is fulfilled and so on. But I have a constant signal here, so I have a constant picture here on the delay time base. So the effect cannot be seen very clear, but you see it jumps. Let me see when I increase it here. Ah, okay. I think you can see it a little bit better. That's the normal behavior of the delay time base when it is triggered. Standalone triggered, and it has always the same condition and makes a constant picture here in a constant signal here. Okay, I can also show only the delayed time base alone. It's also possible when I could trigger mine time base. So I have here a picture only of the delayed time base. Dual is both, and there is trace separation. It works also very fine here. But this is the trace can be separated if wanted. That's the position for both total and separated position here. On the first glance, it looks rather reasonable what's coming out here, what the result is. So I think I have a feeling there is no big failure inside, only the input circuit is a little bit sensitive in the 2 millivolt position. Maybe it's better when the case is closed here, when you have the case on. It's rather open here at the moment, but I will check for other reasons. Next step is to check the memory function. And now the test of the storage function, a first functional test. There's an input signal of roughly 2 kHz here, connected to the channel A. And I will store it, try to store it in a single shot. First I go to single here on the time base here. And then take memory off. And good, I have to go to write. To read, that was not sufficient, I think. Okay, now can I read? It's important to have the intensity here high enough to write a good picture. Then the stored picture, this picture is stored now. I can take it off here, the input signal, so it is really stored here. It can be displayed. It's a 2 kHz signal. I can repeat it with a different waveform. Now I have switched to a triangle. Go again to right. Persistence has to be adjusted in a suited way. Now it's a triangle function here. There's also a possibility for maximum write speed. It's not maximum write speed here, it's for low frequencies in the range of kilohertz. For the check says for 20 kilohertz. Now I have a signal input of 20 kilohertz. Time base can should be set also to 0.1 millisecond as here. Okay, it's a 20 kilohertz signal. It's also stored. You see some traces here in the picture. This is a part of the history of the CRT. Seems there were some spurs in it, some other traces, so it's not so good, but okay, it's typically for many old analog CRTs. When you get them after decades of use, they have such traces in, can't be changed. I increase the go to 20 microseconds per, and then send to the right. Okay, read again, but I think it's still good here. A nice picture. It's with 20 microseconds per division. Let's go to 10. Still okay. I've increased the intensity now to the most left setting, the clockwise setting. Then the display is stored again. I can increase it, let me say, to 5 microseconds and go up in frequency to 200 kilohertz. Okay, there's still something visible. This is now 1 microsecond per division in the horizontal. It's rather good here. Still a signal can be stored. I will change the sine function. Right. Okay. Yes, it means in general the scope is so far okay. I have some problems with contacts identified and other things. One of the knobs here. This knob here, you can see this. can be pulled out very easy, but push in is it's rather hard. I think there's a problem with the switch, and maybe I have identified it. It's installed a little bit twisted. It's not so clear where this problem comes from. Maybe I have to take out the switch and realign it mechanically or clean it simply. Some of the pots here also have this knob here is very sensitive for erase. When I want to touch it, I don't press it down. I want to touch it a little bit, then it erases. So it makes no sense to leave it as it is. It needs cleaning of all contacts. And then the next topic will be, of course, the blue capacitors here. As we talked about the blue capacitors here, but that's another topic. Now I have decided to take out all the blue capacitors here to change them. The new ones are ordered, but there's a problem how to get access to them, how to take them out of the PCB board. There are principally two solutions. I could remove this amplifier board here. This is the amplifier part here, the two channels. This is the time-based part here. By unplugging here the connectors and something, I would have to desolder it and so on. Or second solution is I leave it in place and remove this part here and shift it out of the scope. This part here is, as we can see, the switching of the time base and the both channels here, the input of the channels. This can be shifted out in forward direction by disconnecting something. I've examined what is easier. I think the second method is easier to remove this out of the scope. Additionally, I want to clean these contacts here. We have seen that these contacts here are a little bit not so clean. They are dirty, rather sensitive, touchy. So I think it's better to take them out and clean them outside of the scope, because when I use any deoxid and so on, it will make some pollution inside the complete scope here, and that's what I don't want. So I will try to take it out, and the description here in the manual is also in this direction, to remove this here with the front assembly here and to disconnect it. Many of the connections here are plugged, as you can see here. Here, and so on. I think some are soldered, these three here. Is maybe a ground connection here, but I'm not quite sure. Maybe it's also with an AMP plug here. So it looks a little bit easier to remove this part and to bring it out of the scope here. I will do it. It's very important when doing such a thing here to write down and make some photos what you have done. Step 1, 2, 3. Note every wire, note every connection. You disconnected this 1, 2, 3. And when you later reinstall the unit, you do it in installing in reverse order. Start with the latest point and then so on until you come to the first point, which is then done as the last point. So you can't forget anything. Don't and you don't mix up, don't hash up anything. I think it's the easiest way and the most safe way. It's a little bit time consuming. Make photos, take a photograph, photo, and note down what you are doing here, step by step. Otherwise, you will forget to make a connection, or you make it in the wrong way and so on, and you will have a problem which you can look for it. It will take hours to look such a fault. So it's not so easy. The best way is to note it down step by step. That's what I will do. One small hint for taking out this part here, the front panel assembly, it's necessary to remove the knobs here because this part here is staying in place, but the front face here goes out there. To remove the knobs, it's necessary to remove these caps here, but they are rather old, and if you use a screwdriver, go in there and then you make, then it makes ping, and then you have the problem. The plastic is very old and not so good. A better solution is to take a knife, remove it a little bit, take it a little bit up, and for further action, remove very, very small plastic pieces, so-called guitar picks or plectron. It's a guitar pick which guitar players are using. And these things are very useful. They are very, very small, very flat, and can be used for nearly any purpose to go under the plastic here. They are hard enough to have to make force on it, but soft enough not to damage anything. It can be used for many purposes, but also for using such caps here. And I will demonstrate how it can go. Oops, not so good here. A little bit can be done with the finger, of course. If you have lifted it a little bit, then you can take a stronger one. These picks are available in different sizes. Ah, now it goes. Now it comes. Well, it is out. And as you can see, it's undamaged. Again, if you use a screwdriver, the danger of damaging such caps here is very, very high. I've tried to remove the front panel as described in the manual, but I failed. It was not possible. I don't know what happens, but this plate here is faceplate is blocked by being taken out here by something. I don't know what it is, but I can't do it. It's not possible. I've removed all knobs, all screws on the backside as described and so on, but still it stuck here. So I've started to remove the amplifier board here. Unplugged, unsoldered, all terminals. These I have to unplug again. Also on the lower side here, you can see a lot of connections now are loose here. to avoid problems when I reinstall it, I made a list, as I told you, where I wrote down or made some notes here. Whatever I've done, be able to remount it, and also made some photos with my camera to have a reference where later when I do it in the reverse direction to connect it again. Otherwise I will have big problems, because not all connections are obvious where they belong to. Some connections are a little bit difficult to find where they belong to. So it's always good to have a reference to do it. Now the board here, Ypsilon amplifier and time-based board, is out. All connectors are loose here. You see also the other connectors here. My list goes up to item number 34 items here, which I have to reinstall again. But now the Y amplifier board is loose here, and I can go to change the capacitors and also look by the front panel still stuck here. I don't know what is here inside. There must be something inside here which blocks it, but I'm sure I will find it. I think I found the problem. The manual I have, the service manual from the 3219, requires to remove these knobs here. but it's not exactly the manual of the 3219. It's a manual. This part is more or less for the 3217, for the scope which has no storage functions. And when I try to take out it here, it hangs here on these two screws, because this plate here, this PCB here, is connected with two screws to the front panel here. So I have to remove these two screws here. And these connectors, the first one is connected here now, and the second one I will connect, and then I can take out it with this board here. This will be the next step here. Remove these two screws, and I hope then this board here also goes out. And by the way, if you're asking why this pot here is unmounted, there's a big washer, and I have the feeling it blocks also the movement here. This construction is a little bit odd. I don't know what happened here, but there's such a big washer. I have to look at it. I've unmounted it, so it should be go out now much easier than before. So, and this pot here doesn't block the movement. And yes, now thumbs up, it comes out here. That was the reason, not documented or wrong documentation for the wrong scope in the service manual. I can take it out slowly, carefully, but it should work now. What's happening here again? I hope it's not this pot here, which makes the next trouble here. I have to look at it, but in general, the problem of the faceplate here is now solved. And indeed, as I've assumed, I had also to unsolder these three connections here. It's a pot for the trace rotation here. And this wire goes out with the front here. When I move the front outside, so these wires have to be removed. I don't want to move the pot out with it due to the axis here and so on. So it's easier to note the arrangement here and to take it out with the whole front assembly here. Now I hope it's all I have to do and I can move it out. I can't believe it. After a long battle, indeed I managed to get also the front panel out of the scope on the left side here. You can see it here. This one, this is an amplifier board, wire amplifier and time base board, where I have to replace some electrolytic caps. And here I have to clean some contacts which made trouble during switching the voltage ranges. This will be the next step. Cleaning contacts, exchanging capacitors, and then remount the whole unit. I hope I get it back again. And now to the cleaning of the input attenuator of the two channels. Here are the two channels, the input connectors, and the switches are behind there. But they are not very good accessible, because they are nearly completely shielded, as you can see here. There's everywhere a metal shield around, copper strips, grounded and so on. The only slot here where I can get into it is here, is this slot here. And there are wafer switches. They have two sides. One side is rather easy to get from here, from this side, to spray in here. But the other side, which is behind, cannot be reached with this direction here. So I've built an auxiliary nozzle here, an auxiliary head for this purpose. I'll show it to you. It sprays nearly 180 degrees back. It's a sort of it's a plastic pipe here, bend it back a little bit under heat, some wire in it, then I bend it back, put the wire out. And this is a heat shrink tube here, and this can I add to my spray, so I can spray also in this direction back to me. And when I go into it here, into the slot here, I think you can imagine how it works here. Then I can also spray the other side of the wafer switch, and I can get it. I have to be careful not to bring too much of the spray onto this circuit board here, where the trimmers are, the capacitive trimmers are, because they are very sensitive, and if there gets some spray in it, some deoxid or similar like this, then maybe they change their capacity and it wouldn't be good. So I have to look for it only to be in this position here, and to spray it in this position, this upright position here, and then spray here in, and look at that, the spray comes out here and not reaches the upper PCB here. Other contacts are easy to access. They are laying here on this side here, and they can be accessed rather easy to clean. These are the time switches here, time per division, and also the pots for the variation can reach there rather easily. But the next job I have to do, clean it and see what happens. And now there's also a good moment to remove this storage board here to have a better access to these capacitors here, the blue capacitors, and to avoid any problems when reinstalling it, I mark the plugs here, the pin connections here, with a black pen here to have the correct polarity when inserting it back, and not to change it by 180 degrees can happen here. It's all loose here, so it can maybe happen that they could have a wrong orientation. To avoid this, some hint is always good to have the correct polarity. And now to this potentiometer and switch here. It's a level slope control here. It's a little bit weird mounted here with a big washer here, and it has contact to this aluminium profile here on the rear side here. So I think it's necessary to take some material away from it to have a better mounting here to avoid any mechanical stress on it. And I hope it's going a little bit smoother than when I'm using it, especially the switch on the axis here, in and out. It's a little bit hard to actuate here. This will be the next task, to remove material. So I have to take out this aluminium profile here over the whole length, and then to remove some material. Now removed some material here, and hope it helps to solve this problem here. Looks a little bit homemade. It is homemade, but it's not a beauty contest. The storage board is also out here. You can see the screws are collected here. I've removed several PC boards, so it's a good idea to save the different screws for each board separately, because sometimes there are differences regarding length, diameter, washer, spring washer or not a spring washer, and so on. So to avoid any problem, it's good to save, okay, these separately, these screws for this board here, other screws I've saved in a separate box, and so on. So I cannot mix them up and get no problems, because sometimes it's dangerous when screws are too long. They go through the chassis and maybe touch other circuits on the other side and can cause a short circuit or so. Next step here is to remove these capacitors here and replace them by new ones. I got them, I received them from my distributor now, and I can start. Now I had to replace the seven electrolytic caps here on the storage board. That's the result here. And I will check them against the specification, whether it was really necessary to remove them. We start with a 47 microfarad. I'm measuring at 120 Hz again. Should have 47 microfarad. Actually, it has 20 microfarad. You can see it, yes. a little bigger here. So, okay. 47 should have. This one should have 4.7 microfarad. 5.6. This is one of the good guys here. I place it here. Next one should have 33 microfarad. It is 14 microfarad. One check in serial mode. Okay, in serial mode we have 18 microfarad, but it doesn't make it much better. It has definitely to go. This one is 10 microfarad. Okay. They're all specified with minus 10%. 10 microfarad minus 10% is 9 microfarad. They have 8.9. Okay. I'm not satisfied, really. This one is also 10 microfarad. Okay. Could be accepted, theoretically. This one is 10 microfarad again. Same topics, 10 minus 10%. Not good. And the last one should have 33 microfarad. Actually, it has 13. Okay. That's the result. From 7 electrolytic caps, 2 are within tolerance. Some are nearby the limit of the tolerance, and the rest is out of tolerance. So it was surely a good idea to replace all them. To have installed new ones. Again, I replaced the original values by a little bit higher values, if appropriate, because I didn't get exactly the same values. For example, I looked for capacitors with 33 microfarad 16 volt. I have chosen 47 microfarad and 25 volts. They have same size as the old ones. Higher voltage rating is always good, and higher capacity doesn't matter, because these capacitors are all specified or all intended for filtering purpose. They are filtering the power supply. They are not specified or used for any time stages or timing stages. For time, these yellow caps here are intended and adjusted with the pots here. For the storage board, there are specified sequences for an analog CRT, which have to follow a specific sequence with specific times. And these specific times are adjusted with these pots here and are defined with these caps here, with the yellow caps here. It's not a good, or there would not be a good idea to use electrolytic caps for time relevant stages, because electrolytics tend to change their capacity over the years. It would be a bad design, but in this case it is not a bad design. The relevant capacities are all our foil caps here, like these, and again they are only for filtering. I will put the storage board back into the scope, and then the next step will be the amplifier board. The storage board is back in place again. The connectors, as far as possible, are plugged in. And now the amplifier and time-based board here is waiting for the new electrolytic caps here. By the way, I have found that the documentation is not completely. There is one capacitor not mentioned in the parts list, but in the schematic and in this layout, it's existing. So I have one capacitor more. It's always a good idea to compare it, to have a print of the part list, of the layout, and of the schematic, and compare it. Sometimes equipment is modified over the years of production, so some components disappear or suddenly appear, which are not in the
in the service manual, it's not always the actual state you have. Okay, I will exchange now the capacitors here in the time base and amplifier unit here. It's the biggest job now to do. In the background, they're sitting here, the drum panel with the switches. I've cleaned the contacts and I'm waiting another day until they are dried out, completely dried out. And then I can reinstall it. But in the moment, the most important thing is to reinstall and to change all the capacitors here. All capacitors in the wire amplifier, channel 1, channel 2, and time base, main and delayed, are exchanged. The blue types here are all new. And this is a result of the whole action. Exactly 50 capacitors are out from the whole scope. That's a layout of the amplifier and time base again. I marked all capacitors, which I had to exchange, not to forget any capacitor. And this list here helped me to use always the right type here and not the wrong type. Amplifier, storage, power supply, and focus. There's noted where which capacitor is, and so I could exchange them exactly. Only one, again, is not changed. It's a big one in the rectifier circuit, in the 50 Hz circuit. This is left in place because it was very good. Okay, the next step is I will show you a small statistic, how it looked like, which capacitors were really bad. So I will measure all of the 50 and show you a little diagram. And now a little bit statistic. I've exchanged all capacitors in this scope, exactly 50 types. 50 types of capacitors are changed. And I have made a scale starting from 0% up to 100% of nominal capacitance. Measured them all again, and here I can show you what is the result. I have a lot of capacitors which only have 50% of their capacity measured at 120 Hz. Two or three nearly total loss. These two were in the power supply here. 50% were a lot of capacitors on the Y amplifier and time base. And here are some with 90%, but I say they are bad because less than 90% is bad. The tolerance is minus 10%. And if they have minus 11%, so they are bad. Good is only this part here. There are also some capacitors more. Some have more than 120% on the right side here. Anyhow, this distribution shows us that the capacitors in the scope general had a problem. And more or less all had to be exchanged. Some could have been in place, but it's not a very good decision to take them not out. They all had to go. The Y amplifier board and time base board is in place now. The front unit with all the switches, pots and so on is also in place together with the attenuator here. Here's an attenuator and time base settings. All wires are prepared for plugging in. They are identified which plug belongs to which receptacle here. It's important to look that even small wires have their location here and that they are on the right side of the board. Some are going under the board onto the other side, like here. It has to be done before everything is plugged in, because the latest one maybe can't be fed through the wiring. These have to be soldered here, plugged in, and so on. So it can be done. Again, it was very useful to have some pictures here on the laptop here, and to have also this list here, which I'm working through now from the bottom top up, reverse direction when I started unmounting, and now the mounting again starts in the reverse direction to bring all the connections to the right place. And now the work is done. The vertical amplifier and time-based section is in place. All screws are screwed, fixed. Soldering points, of course, the blue capacitors are exchanged here. You see also the blue caps here in the power supply. It was one of the first actions I did. There's also the high voltage cascade, which one can see here. The black one with the graphite screening here, which was the first topic. The second topic we had to clarify. The first one was the wrong filter capacitor here. Under this paper here, inside is the line filter here. Here you can see the other blue caps connections. I had one problem with one of the pins here, for the single pins here. One of the pins broke off when I inserted the counter contact. So I had to remove the whole PCB, and it was a pin right there inside. It was a little bit difficult. Completely remove it again, resoldered the pin, and then I started mounting again. All these wires here are connected. So I will make a little performance check whether the specification is fulfilled, and will decide how it works. But first, a demonstration of the result. And now a quick performance check. It's a 50 MHz signal on channel 1, 50 ohm termination at the input here. And you see here a stable triggering. Amplitude, of course, is a little bit decreased related to lower frequencies, but it is exactly the 3 dB limit. 0.707 times voltage of lower frequencies. When I reduce the frequency to 25 MHz, you see it jumps up, and at, for example, 10 MHz or 12.5, I have nearly full screen. At 4 units, 50, it is 2.8 is 4 times 0.7, that is 2.8, so it is rather exactly at 50 MHz the limit. Let's have a look at the second channel here. Channel B, trigger also on channel B. Why doesn't it trigger here? What did, okay, it's zero here. Same height at 50 MHz, both channels. Position works, of course. Then we can have a quick look at the delayed time base. It must also be triggered at B. Why does it not come here? Triggered B, internal. What did I wrong here? Here we go. The level was not okay here. A little bit too fast okay, 0.1 microsecond here, and here also 0.1 microsecond. That makes, of course, no sense. It's a little bit beyond a useful application, so I have to reduce here the speed. Okay, and then we can see the position of the delayed signal. We can reduce a little bit the amplitude, shift it over the wanted signal. And when we make alternate both time bases and a little bit of trace separation, so we see here the portion of the signal. It's only a sine wave, and okay, if I go to main time base, not triggered, but to main time base, then it's a fixed time where the signal is shifted. It works even at 50 MHz, you see. Can go to a lower frequency.
Na, einmal 6 MHz hier. Okay. It's a little bit more interesting for demonstration purpose here. And yeah, so here, smaller amplitude here. So this portion here is displayed here. So we see it works as it should. When I go to triggering channel B, then it jumps from trigger point to trigger point. That means this picture here is always the same, because it's a constant sine wave, so it makes no sense to jump over it. But you see it is now jumping, and it's not sliding above the picture. It jumps from trigger point to trigger point here. Then I go to mine time base, variable time delay. This also works. That stress separation here, as I told. It looks good. In the next video sequence I will try the storage function, whether it's also okay, and then we will see. And now again an old topic. When I repaired the high voltage cascade, you remember, there was a moment when we had a very bright trace here, which couldn't be controlled with the intensity control. It was always bright. Maybe you remember when the HV cascade was repaired, this effect was also gone, but it is not gone. It is still present. I found here one transistor, and when I touched this transistor here, you see a flickering intensity. It goes up very bright, and this transistor here controls the intensity. It's a transistor here in this circuit. It's a V1523 SIC, and this is a intensity control here. Intensity is controlled here in this circuit, and this is a preset of the intensity via internal trimmer, and this goes to the grid here, to the control grid of the CRT. And if there is a problem in the transistor or in the contacts, then of course the intensity will show this effect here. This transistor is plugged. I don't know why. All other transistors, I think I have identified the problem. One of the three pins of the transistor here, its center pin here, is considerably shorter than the other two pins here. So it could be the reason for the bad contact and for the flickering intensity of the trace. I will make the other two pins a little bit shorter and try to make the center pin a little bit longer. It is bended absolutely rectangular, which makes no sense in this case. So I hope to get an equal length of all three pins, and then I have a better contact. This problem is also solved now. I replaced the transistor here, cut the length of the three pins into equal length, used some deoxy D100L, 100% solution, one drop per pin, not more, cleaned it a little bit, and then, as you see, when I'm wiggling around here, nothing happens. So I think it's okay now. I did the same procedure with this transistor here. The soldering on the bottom side is okay, so there's no problem. It was only a problem of the contact of the pins. I've made a performance check. All the deviation factors here, the time and voltage settings are okay. The volt and millisecond per division and so on are okay. And the last measurement I'm doing here is now the rise time. The scope is specified 50 MHz with approximately 7 nanoseconds. I have here a very fast generator with 125 up to 125 MHz. It's set now to 10 MHz with a rise time of 1 nanosecond. I'm feeding into this cable and this 50 ohm termination into the first channel here, and I see
with the magnifier on. Show it a little bit better here to you. Unfortunately, there is no graphical illumination here in the scope. It's a pity that the scope doesn't have this. It's roughly a 10 megahertz signal. We have a setting of 0.1 microsecond per division. That means 100 nanoseconds per division. And when I take out the magnifier, then we can see we have only one signal per division. Here we have 10 per 10 over the whole screen, and we have one over the screen here. This means we have 10 nanoseconds per division in the moment. And when I make the standard procedure, so we have to look for a little bit better. I think that's a good compromise here now. The amplitude is set between 0, it's a dotted line 0%, and the other dotted line is 100%. And I set the scope, the x-axis, to 10%, then the 90% is at 4 nanoseconds, because this here is 10 nanoseconds. So that would indicate a rise time of approximately 4 nanoseconds, not 7 as stated. Maybe due to the other vertical amplifier, to the new version or other version, the rise time is better, because 4 nanoseconds is very good. It's more or less a specification of a scope approaching 100 megahertz, not 50 megahertz. So I'm a little bit surprised here. I will look at the other channel here, whether we have the same result. Take the zero out here. Looks identical. 0%. Again, between the 10% and 90%, we have 4 nanosecond rise time here. I think it's a good result here for this scope. There is a small rounded edge here. I don't know where it comes from. It may be it's a generator, the cable I don't believe. Maybe it's a termination here, or it's in the scope. I'm not so sure. But I can switch the wrong direction. Can switch this generator here I have also to a rise time of 1.5 or 2 nanoseconds. The picture doesn't change here. So I'm quite sure here that the problem is not the generator here. The generator seems to be okay with the impulse here. I will check it with another scope. I have a 500 megahertz scope here from Tektronix. So I will have a look at the generator, whether it's okay or not. And then I can check also this termination here. And then I will see where this rounded edge comes from. Maybe it's required to have a readjustment of the scope here. Anyhow, job is done. I have only one problem, a little bit cosmetic here. And what I have seen here, the filter here, the colored filter here faded out. It's not blue any longer. I have to look for a new filter to make a better picture, because this faded out blue filter foil is not so nice. It looks a little bit bad, and I think it should be improved. The original cover of the CRT, the colored acrylic glass, is not good any longer. It was a light blue, I think it was light blue, but it faded out. It got a little bit green, or a mixture of blue and green, and looked not so good at a close look at it. So I decided to replace it. I will make it in two layers in the future. I will take a protective cover like this. It's a fully transparent acrylic glass. Thickness is exactly 0.5 millimeters as the old one. And behind this acrylic glass, I will place a colored foil. For example, this is light blue again, other blue, green, yellow, and so on. I bought a set of several colors. It's for lighting technologies for discos, bars, and so on. And I will cut them. It's necessary to use precise tools here and have some training. I'm not a trained cutter, and you see there are several attempts I've made to come to a result. Now checking the various colors I bought. Start with yellow. Looks rather good. It is good for the yellow-green trace here, and the graticule is still very strong visible. Another interesting color would be, of course, the green one here. But the graticule fades out a little bit. Next one would be light blue. This light blue here comes very close to the original. The graticule is also still visible, and it is very close to the original one I have here. When I take it out, you see it's very, very close to the original color. This light blue here. I have another blue, it's a little bit standard blue, a little bit darker. Okay, why not? Here we have, as I see, okay, this blue here is a little decisive, too dark here. I can't see the graticule, it's not good for this purpose. Okay, I have to decide, but you see the advantage is it's changeable. You can cut out a piece what you want and then place it and throw it away if it is not good for you, for your purpose. It depends very strong upon the conditions, the conditions around light and so on, whether you have direct sunshine on it or not. So it's not always to find an exact best solution, also depending upon your eyes and what you prefer to see or not to see. So do what you want or simply leave it clear. I've cut the clear acrylic glass now into this bezel here, so you see there's nothing. It's also a good solution, why not? But I will take as original one the light blue. That's my favorite. And I will cut out a piece of it, and then we will see. And that's the result. Light blue. Of course, I cleaned it very carefully with soap water, and to avoid any dust on it, any fingerprints and so on, is a little bit difficult. But now it's ready. I think the picture here from the screen is great. When I reduce the light here, okay, would have to reduce the other light here also. I think you can imagine it. It's a very great appearance on the CRT here. And with such a CRT, we can work. And now, my friends, we finally come to an end. The scope is ready. Starting with a smoke generator due to a defective capacitor and the line input filtering over the trouble with the HV cascade. All electrolytics had to be exchanged, troubles with a transistor which had contact problems in a socket. You remember the intensity control didn't work, and finally a new blue filter here. This is all done. Performance check now. So the scope is ready. I think it's like new and has many, many years of new useful usage in his future. It was interesting for me. I've learned something about such old scopes. Whether I wouldn't do it a second time, I don't know. It was a little bit longer than I've estimated, but I'm glad to reach now the finish. It's late in the night, or maybe early in the morning, I don't know. Anyhow, I've decided to drink a beer. Prost.